Hello, welcome back. Glad to see some faces still in the crowd, so thank you for that. Next panel, we're starting off. On behalf of Jenny Osborne's work, we're having Dr. Ruth Nugent, who's gonna be presenting it. And it's the corpse and the skeleton, untimely death interpretation and presentation in museums. Thank you.
Thank you very much, although I really can't take any credit for this at all. So as Brian said, this is on behalf of Jenny Osborne. So the particular presentation today is tying in quite nicely with the theme of that we've just looked in our previous panel, looking at how bodies in particular and their representation and presentation to the public in contemporary society can be quite ambiguous, and how both museums and the public try to negotiate these kind of quite limbo, liminal bodies that we're going to be looking at. So as you can see on the screen there, we have a picture of Lindo Man, a very famous bog body found in Cheshire in 1984. And it's been on display at the British Museum since 1989. And this particular body is the focal point for Jenny's research, looking at how this particular body has been presented to the public. So it was originally argued that the gentleman who was killed was actually a sacrificial killing in the European Iron Age. As a form of this very well-known and well-discussed practice of the triple death, three different modes of killing the deceased. Richard Hutton, however, in 2011, has since argued that this evidence is not does not entirely support his claim, and has also been further researched by people like Karen Pollock, who've also argued that some of these bog bodies actually may have been subjected to various forms of taphonomy, i.e. the breakdown and decay of the body, its movement around the bog, other influencing factors such as later methods of collecting peat from the bogs, may have also contributed to what have been supposed to be original methods of death. So the interpretation of this body and where it stands in our understanding of what bog bodies actually represent in terms of ritual sacrifice is liminal in its own right. There is no standard narrative at the moment exactly. That is quite a contentious subject. So instead it's been argued that Hutton's versions that there could have been five injuries that we're potentially looking at, not just three, and it may have actually been the murder or killing of a criminal. So therefore, this movement away from interpreting this body as a sacrifice of some kind of, considered to be some kind of elevated person in society or someone with very strong cosmological symbolism for that particular society has now moved into another category that maybe this is a social deviant, somebody who had to be punished. The criticism of this interpretation of Lindo Man has led to the information boards, as Jenny's looked at the British Museum, presenting him in a very specific kind of way, allowing the reader to negotiate this kind of multiple interpretations, conflicting views themselves, and to come to their own conclusions as to the nature of his death, as to why he was killed. Now, as you can see, he's tucked away in a tiny corner in the British Museum. And he's not readily accessible to the public. And one of the ways that this has been justified is it's to prevent crowds from gathering around him. So the part of it is to help the public discover him, but are not immediately confronted with his body. Now, whether or not this is this actually plays into the tactic of mediating encounters with the very fleshed dead, whether this works is an interesting idea. Having been tucked away in a corner, you could easily accidentally stumble across him and not realise immediately what you're looking at until closer inspection. Is that really a useful way of preventing the public, or at least highlighting the public what they're about to encounter before they actually stumble upon it? That itself is quite a contentious issue. In this particular area of the museum, there's very low lighting, so it's not as easy to see, and it creates a very strong sense of intimacy with this particular body. He's laid out in a surrounding sort of soil, and in the background you can just make out there that they've posted alongside it a depiction of, to give some kind of context, a representation of the area in which he was found. And so a lot of this is about kind of an attempt by the British Museum to downplay this particular kind of body. So when contemporary audiences encounter a bog body, such as something as iconic as the Lindow Man, they are forced to interpret it themselves. There's not a huge amount of information presented there. There's just a few information boards, but a lot of it, as Chiara was looking at before and some of the other speakers today, a very strong visual representation is what immediately provokes you to try and interpret what you're looking at, both the body itself and a representation of the context in which it was found. And this is quite important for bog bodies because, unlike other kinds of inhumations, where these can be represented in museums alongside their grave goods, alongside their coffins or within replicas of their coffins or even their boats or chariots, whatever they've been found with, in the terms of bog bodies, they were never visible above ground and they were always underwater. And of course, that underwater effect can't really be replicated in the way an inhumation can. So even the context in which it's found is quite ambiguous because it can't be fully represented here. It still creates a sort of liminal sense that we're looking at a body that's out of context, but they've tried to give us a nod towards it. And this leads on to further ideas about how contemporary members of society encounter and read bog bodies. And one of the interesting aspects that Jenny's pulled out is most of them have been given names. We had no idea what their original names were, but they have names such as Lindow Man or Greybold Man. And that in itself presents an idea that they are very distinct individual entities with their own identity. And there's a strong desire to create an identity for them, even retrospectively, that maybe cremated remains, even in the same museum, would not be be given. But the name itself doesn't tell us a huge amount. It tells us normally the context, the area in which it was found, in a sense of location and connection there. But it gives us very little idea of who that person actually was. It's an attempt, again, to kind of negotiate this ambiguity of an unnamed person that is so fleshed and human and recognisable to us. And yet we have no name for them. And so that this is kind of mediated by trying to at least give a sense of their location identity, if not who they were in real life. And of course, this leads on to all the osteological analysis of looking at the contents of their stomachs and the clothing that they've been wearing and the various attributes that may have been found alongside them, as well as the manner of death. So from that perspective, we are looking here at a way to place these bodies in a respectful manner. And many of the talks thus far that we've heard have been coming back to this idea of how can we treat the dead in a respectful manner. And as Jenny's been looking through her research, many of the publications in the academic world have been about how do we respectfully, excavate and display skeletal remains. More recently, the work by Howard and Mel Giles and their edited volumes looking about cremations and adding them to the discussion. What is respectful and how can we display them? But in terms of bog bodies, what Jenny's noticed in particular was how these have not received as much of a discussion necessarily about respectfulness, but about attempting to overcome this idea that they're kind of a freak show. Then, and her observations at the British Museum, it was talking with people there, it's almost like people are embarrassed that they have such a recognisably human body on display. And the concept of that these are very much individuals as opposed to these sort of less identifiable cremated remains and other inhumations where their identity might be facilitated by their immediate grave goods. But this in turn leads on to, it generates further thoughts about how we can think about these very sort of liminal bodies and the way that they create an emotional effect on the viewer. So to kind of summarise, thinking about these bodies, there's a sense of, as we've mentioned before, a nervousness about the intimacy, the potential for intimacy that can be created. And you'll notice how kind of low down this particular display is. To get close, you'd have to sort of get into a more crouched, low position, get physically close to it. So many of the bog bodies, not just Lindow Man, offer us very intimate aspects of their bodies, such as their fingerprints or their eyelashes or aspects of hair that we don't normally see being preserved. And these also have to be negotiated by the individual viewer. And in many respects, they still continue to exist in limbo. They're often moved around from museum to museum so people can see them at different areas. They themselves are in a state of stasis. They are dead, but they look asleep, yet they're not awake. They are semi-clothed. They're not completely nude, but at the same time, they still have clothing. They haven't decayed. They're not skeletonized. They're not cremated. And yet they're not fully alive, of course. And therefore, within the academic realm as well, are they deviants? Are they sacrifices? Are they murder victims? Even the interpretation is ambiguous. So with no definitive final narrative or even final status attached to these particular bodies, and their decontextualization outside of the bog itself allows many viewers to reinterpret the individual however they wish to. Thank you very much.
When there is archaeology, there will always be mortuary archaeology. No matter what society or area of the world archaeologists explore, there will always be the discovery of human remains and mortuary evidence. However, I believe that it is what the mortuary archaeology tells us and how it can be used to give information of past societies, and that is what gives it relevance today. The Great North Museum is a local museum in Newcastle that contains a variety of artifacts and exhibits. I have written and posted this blog about my experience in the Egyptian exhibit within the Great North Museum, detailing the mortuary archaeology. As you can see, my blog shows a number of pictures from the exhibit. As you enter the exhibition, you are greeted with statues, a variety of glass cases containing canopic jars and death masks. The further you walk into the exhibition, the more you become engrossed into the attitudes around death in the ancient Egyptian world. To the side of the exhibition, along the back wall, there is a glass case containing a well-preserved mummy and its original sarcophagus. The exposed mummy is the main attraction of the museum, according to surveys taken in 2010, 2011, and 2012 by Hugh Kilmeister. The mummy is openly displayed, however, it is in an area of the exhibition that is not necessary to walk to or past, therefore it is not in direct view, so those who do not wish to see the human remains don't have to if they don't wish to. The other, however, is still in its original sarcophagus and therefore is not openly on display to the public. When in the exhibition, it is hard to ignore a large tunnel that is in the middle of the room titled Journey to the Afterlife, as you can see on that picture there. The tunnel allows visitors to walk through and watch and listen to a video that plays on loop constantly, talking you through the stages of the journey to the afterlife. This is very popular with people of all ages at the museum and can be seen as a key learning tool in understanding the ancient Egyptian afterlife. Based on work by Myra Gilson and the English Heritage, out of 100 visitors that were asked at the museum, 97% of them stated that they would expect to see a mummy on display when visiting a museum and an Egyptian exhibition. When asked in a different survey by Myra Gilson in 2013, 92% of visitors to the museum stated that they think that by seeing a mummy, this increases their learning experience of the ancient Egyptian world. These are extremely high figures and cannot be ignored, and the visitors of the Great North Museum in 2013 are clearly shown here their views on the significance of remains to their museum experience, as more than the majority feel like seeing a mummy in human remains enhances their learning experience. We all know that death played a large role within Egyptian society. It was not thought of lightly, and the journey into the afterlife was seen as just, or if not more important than the journey through life. Tombs and burials were planned and well thought out within ancient Egyptian society, as in the majority of societies, and therefore what is within those tombs and burials would have been included or excluded for specific reasons. This is why ancient Egyptian mortuary archaeology is so important and relevant to today's society, as it allows us to see into the society and thinking of the ancient Egyptians. For instance, if we had nothing but burials and tombs and what was contained within them, then look at what mortuary archaeology tells us and gives us. We get tomb paintings depicting society, day-to-day life, farming, celebrations, and of a hierarchy. We also have information from seeds and plant residue that would have been found within tombs and burials. That allows us to see what plants were grown and used in ancient Egypt. This allows us to identify which plants were seen to be of enough substantial value to be buried with the dead and be taken on their journey in the afterlife. We also have evidence of animals that have been buried within the tombs and burials. This is relevant as it allows us to see which animals were wanted in the journey to the afterlife. Animal remains also allow us to try and understand the relationship between certain animals and humans in the ancient world. Mortuary archaeology within the ancient Egyptian world also allows us to see evidence of slaves and sacrifices. We can see equipment with evidence of chariots to writing materials. The evidence of slavery and writing materials of the time allows us more of an insight into how ancient Egyptian society worked at the time and what was and wasn't valued enough to be placed in the tombs and burials. And of course, we have the bodies themselves. The evidence of human remains allows us to see the ancient Egyptians, how they cared for their dead and preserved them for the journey into the afterlife. All of this gives us a picture of ancient Egyptian civilization, and surely that clearly demonstrates that is relevant in today's research. To conclude, within many museums, such as the Great North Museum, mortuary archaeology is extremely popular within the public, and many museums have mummies as star pieces that draw in the crowds. Ancient Egyptian mortuary archaeology is not only relevant in today's society, as it gives us an insight into Egyptian society of the time, but death and the idea of an afterlife is a theory that interests the public, which draws them into exhibits. Mortuary archaeology will always be relevant in today's society, as no matter what society you are from, it is, in its simplest terms, the remains of the dead, and this is something that we can all relate to and always will. And that's it.
So following on quite nicely from themes of that past session, this presentation is about displaying human remains and the controversy that we have to overcome in doing so. As you can see from this quote from Paige, it's quite well known that there is a fascination around death and the world of mortuary archaeology, and it's also important to remember, as Hannah just said, there is no archaeology without human remains, without finding bodies that people have buried in the past. And so poses the question as to what we do with them when we do find them. Do we leave them in the ground? Do we just record them? Or do we excavate them, exhume them, and display them in museums? If we are to go down the route of display, then human remains cannot be exhibited without the consideration of certain factors. So in terms of mortuary archaeology, these are the four sort of general factors that I have pulled out of certain papers. So ethically, we have to consider that this person was once buried by their family, by their loved ones, in a way that they thought was right at the time. And so to dig them up, you know, is that right? You know, we're reversing what they put in the ground. And if for research purposes, if we're pulling them out the ground, does this solely outweigh the need to repatriate the remains for a moral sake? You know, we can justify them by saying, which leads on to educationally, we can say that we're pulling them out the ground to learn something and to teach a lesson to somebody, but does that outweigh the process of exhuming them? Financially, we have to consider that as that last quote said, human remains are quite fascinating for people, and they do tend to draw in crowds. So museums are quite dependent on their human remains exhibitions, earning them quite a lot of money from the paying visitor. So perhaps they don't want to repatriate, they don't want to, or if it's not to repatriate, if not just to take the display off from public viewing, that might decrease a footfall into the museum exhibition. And politically, as Ross touched on, there are certain cultural groups that might not wish for certain remains to be on display because they find it personally offensive. I won't go into it too much as it was in the last presentation quite a lot, but the Lindo Man was an exhibit. It was actually I think it is on display at the British Museum in the minute, but it was displayed in the Manchester Museum from April 2008 to 2009. And it was received quite badly. The exhibition was only there for a year. I'm not sure if it was intended for longer, but criticism of the display brought quite a lot of controversy. I won't go into it. Obviously, it was a bog body. There's some pictures. So this display was, you know, it wasn't just a skeleton. It looks more human, perhaps. And that picture at the bottom is also a contributions box that the Manchester Museum put in. And this was for visitors to offer money donations and also donations of anything else that they wanted to leave with the body. Sort of, I guess, like a funeral, maybe, you know, you'd leave flowers. That I'm not sure whose idea it was to do this, but that was also quite controversial. As to why there was controversy, these are a couple of papers that I pulled up. Jenny did touch on the fact that the body was deliberately devoid of any sort of one particular interpretation. At the Manchester Museum, it was actually 8 people gave their own opinions of what the body meant to them, and that ranged from archaeologists to a pagan. There was a landscape archaeologist, and also somebody that just lived in Wilmslow, which is the place where the body was exhumed. In contrast, there is an exhibition called Body Worlds. It's actually, I'm not sure it's all owned by the same company anymore, but it's just a method of plastination, which was created by this guy called Gunther von Hagen. And it's essentially a way that we can preserve. It's not freeze drying. It turns it a bit to plasticine, and the body can be kept for quite a long time after that. It also doesn't need to be kept behind any glass cases. Sorry, I should have warned you. The next few slides are a little bit gruesome, so if you don't want to look, then you don't have to. So as you can see from these pictures, that in my opinion, they're a little bit more gruesome than the Lindo Man exhibition was, yet Body World has been very well received by the general public. There are images of quite a sexual nature in the exhibitions, and there's sort of no age limit on this exhibition either. They've not sort of deemed it unsuitable for children. Children can visit the exhibition with an adult. They've got images of stillborns. I mean, these things don't look real. That's another thing. I'm not sure if perhaps this has been so well received because people look at it and think, you know, it looks like a plasticine model. And remember, these things aren't behind glass cases. Some of them are, and I'm not sure what the reason for that is, but some of them are right up there. You can't touch them, but you can get as close as you want to it, and it doesn't look real. But every muscle, every vein, every artery, even that child is real. And the method of plastination allows us to contort a body before it's plasticized, and it will stay in this position. So instead of, in contrast to when we exhume bodies, we wouldn't tend to display them in any other position other than the one we found them in. The people are able to do so in this way. And I did talk about the need to justify exhibitions. Obviously, whenever you display human remains, that is an important factor. But I'm not sure justification of those 4 points is the most important thing. I personally believe, as Body Worlds has been so well received and the Lindo Man wasn't, that perhaps it's not necessarily the fact that the public aren't willing to look at human remains and that they're put off by the realness of it all or the goriness, because as you can see from those last pictures, that they are quite gory. Yet there's hundreds of thousands of visitors to those exhibitions every year, and it's also these are just some of the exhibitions that have been opened by Body Worlds. They're across a few continents, and also there's some visitor comments on that slide as well. making allowances, obviously, for the following, that we have to remember that Body World is not a museum, it's not an exhibition in a museum, it's a completely separate rented space that they use to display these things, whereas the Lindo Man was in, and still is, in a museum environment. Although I do think it's quite a similar experience. You know, you pay when you get to the door and you walk through, it's not a guided tour, it's just displays with interpretation boards. A donations box was provided at the Lindo Man. The Body Wells doesn't ask for offerings to these people. It doesn't name the individuals. It doesn't tell you how they died. That's not sort of the focus. Body Wells' focus is more educational in like a scientific way. They want to teach people about the effects of smoking, about how amazing the human body is. And so the interpretation of the Body Worlds is very much scientific-based as opposed to archaeological. And, of course, I think maybe perhaps the main thing is that everybody at Body Worlds has donated themselves to the exhibition. And I actually looked at how you go about donating your body to it, and they've got a fully subscribed waiting list. So, like, there are thousands and thousands of people who've already signed up to do this, whereas when we have remains in museums, obviously those people have not consented to us using them. And that's everything.
So hi guys, so obviously as Brian's introduced me, I'm going to be talking about reassessing the popular perception of deviancy. Hang on, how do you use the clicker? So to do this, I'm going to look at our perception of it and discuss if the term can be applied to all burials that we find in the Anglo-Saxon period. Because I have quite often found that archaeologists maybe have a potential fear of emoting to the dead. And I would like us to kind of move away from a negative perception of deviancy to one that understands maybe more a multifaceted identity of the deceased and the roles of the mourners and understand the theatre and performance of death. Because the mourners aren't a faceless mass. They're humans who may have had a world order that they kind of put on these burials, or they may have, like, it might have been a family member, or it might have been someone completely removed from the burial. And I want to understand how our biases can influence our understanding and interpretation of the dead. Because I feel that our interpretation of the dead is odd as we remove ourselves from death. We don't have to handle the remains, we don't have to touch them, we don't even have to see them if we don't want to. But we have a morbid fascination with the dead. We really like strange things, odd things like Lindo Man, like, and Body World. We like to sink our teeth into really weird stuff. But then we're like, when we see dead people, we're kind of like, I just want to remove myself from it. And I often feel that when we have Anglo-Saxon burials, we don't find the flesh, we only find the skeletons. So we can only go on the biological data like age and sex. But what if the deceased was maybe transgender? What if they didn't have any personhood, or, you know, they might have been treated differently in some respect? Sometimes we rely too heavily on the things that are just there, and we need to kind of consider these people as people. So to do this, I'm going to be looking at the Sowerby Woman and Walkington Wold criminal burials as a whole, instead of just one case study. And this is the deviant criteria that I've found. Most other peoples who work on deviancy in Anglo-Saxon burials often follow this kind of pattern as well. But obviously there's like more pieces and less pieces. But it's usually perforated pierced skulls, as you can see, decapitation, broken off or cut off limbs, burials in boundaries or marginal places, lack of grave goods, and unusual orientation. And I think some of this criteria does not show deviancy, but it's a personal choice by the deceased or the mourners that shows a different, maybe less widespread kind of burial that we're seeing. Maybe it's just made by one town, is practicing one type of thing, whereas the whole majority isn't. Like, we know there's loads of different types of burials in Anglo-Saxon England, there's so many. And often I also feel that burials with cut off limbs or broken limbs might just be an occupational hazard. Maybe they were ploughing a field and had a really bad accident, and that might be why they also have a perforated pierced skull. Obviously this isn't for every burial. Obviously some of them, like as you will see in a bit, are definitely deviant, but some of them I think are probably not. So deviancy, much like ritual, is a bit of an overused and complicated term. So things that like we don't understand, sometimes we like to call them deviant and just kind of leave it at that. So like these objects that I'm showing you here are often found in a woman's girdle hanger. The one on the bottom has a ritual, a functional purpose, to show the woman's wealth of society, the key to the house. On the top, we don't really know that much about. I've not really come across any type of interpretation for it. We think it might be for scrying, because women are supernatural, but we're not sure. So I think archaeologists might be in danger of using this word to give burials to meaning and practices that we don't understand. And we might not be seeing deviancy, but emotion-driven acts and performances. So this is like really important in Anglo-Saxon burials. We often find that we have poetry, and I think Martin Carver talks about this quite a bit in one of his works, that theatre and performance needs to be understood and maybe thought of when we're interpreting burials. So criminal burials. They're usually in late Anglo-Saxon England, we start seeing these. They're not normally in the main cemeteries, they're just geographically distinct, normally around barrows or just somewhere else that's not with the main cemetery. They're usually decapitated or treated harshly, and we often find a certain type of treatment for these people due to law codes that we find from like King Alfred and other people like that. Usually they have the hands bound, decapitation, multiple internments. Oh, my notes are all messed up. But I also want to think that these burials are not deviant because we find so many of them. It's not just like one or two burials that we're finding that might have been decapitated. We find these people and they're all buried in the same kind of place. They're all some kind of odd type of treatment to them. I think it's a subgroup of burial, but not perhaps deviant burial. And we have to think, would these burials be public? Or would they be private? Were that the Victorian period where they all like to gather around and look at the burials, because, you know, take your kid to come and see the criminal hang, yay! But then, as I said, they might be negative due to our own association with criminals. We see criminals as quite scary people, they can harm us, but we're not seeing a person anymore, we're seeing a skeleton that can't harm us. And I feel that because we see these people and we see that they've been treated differently and we know this is for criminals, that we treat them differently and we interpret them differently and we need to treat them all maybe sort of similar and not as a deviant person, as a normal kind of person that unfortunate stuff happened to. So this is a Sewerby woman, and I think this burial is deviant and not deviant because she's buried with a stone on her back and she's believed to be a murder victim. But someone brings up an interpretation, I think it's Joe Buckberry, brings up an interpretation that the stone might have been placed on her due to cadaveric spasms, which is actually kind of a rare thing to occur to a corpse. But I think maybe it's like rigor mortis and they kind of got a bit scared of what to do with the corpse and thought it was alive, put the stone on her back. But also, we find in Viking Age Scandinavia that they put stones on people's backs to keep them from returning, especially in winter. They believe that they can rise again and that weighing down the body will help keep them kind of in the ground. But also, the burial was open for quite a long time. We found flies in the grave cut. And also, she's buried with jewelry and she's in a cemetery. She's not on the margins, I don't believe, at least. And if she's a murder victim, why is it open for so long? And why is she still buried with jewelry? Why is she not somewhere like a nondescript place? I'm sorry, the photo is not great. I could not find her burial picture. No one like has it in any kind of publication. It took me ages. But she's buried with quite a few different things. She's buried with annular brooches, jet beads, that's all around her neck and around her wrists. Well, she's buried amber beads, which are quite cool, I think. And bronze fragments. So why she's a murder victim, was she still having objects on her person? Because it's in our contemporary society, unfortunately, people who murder tend to take mementos of their victims, like hair or something like that. And I find it quite strange that she still has objects on her person. So reassessing our opinions, are we insulting the dead by calling them deviant? Like, their identity may have carried on from life to death, at least for a time. Like, if your grandmother dies, they don't suddenly cease becoming your grandmother. They could, you know, have that kind of personhood attached to them for quite a long time afterwards. Maybe they required particular provisions during funeral that made them deviant. So we have, like, music that we play, or we have our bodies presented, or the closed casket, maybe we're cremated. Like Ellen said, they make people into beads, which is odd. So we need to disentangle ourselves from the raw data that we find and the raw biological age and sex and focus on different interpretations rather than a singular one. So not just, oh, she's a murder victim because she's buried on her back, but you know, focusing on, oh, well, the Vikings were doing this, maybe we can place it on this. And just think about the person rather than just the corpse or the skeleton. So by calling burials deviant, are we denying the deceased their identity while disengaging ourselves from our own mortality? Obviously, it's not Lias looking at skeleton and thinking maybe that one day will be us. But I think we kind of need to like push that side away. So deviant burials, we are not taking into consideration how the deceased viewed the world, identified themselves, or how others encountered them. We are only looking at how they're perceived at the moment of death. Unfortunately, a lot of times in the archaeological record, we don't have written records. We just have a snapshot of what's happened at death. We don't have the full album. We don't know how, if that woman, the Subi woman, was a mother, or if she was quite, if she was a cunning woman, or if she was deviant, or it was just by accident that she died. We should not distance ourselves from death in our contemporary society, as Anglo-Saxons would have frequently encountered it. But this is difficult, as we don't know how they thought or they felt. It may be similar to us, it may have been completely different. Obviously, I think differently from all you think. You probably think that right now I'm talking a load of trash. And you're probably right. But we need to kind of think about this more. We need to think about more emotion. And we are doing this in archaeology. We are kind of emoting more, but it's still kind of slow. But I think it will sometimes sort of come together. And we might be like looking at these burials with a preconceptual scheme. There is no one type of burial, as I said before. Reevaluation would be slow, and different interpretations could allow us to understand social identity and social standing a lot better, I feel, as well as the deceased's personal relationship with those burying them. So if we talk our type of funeral and kind of apply those kind of feelings and processes onto maybe Anglo-Saxon burials, we could start to understand them better. We need to consider the performance and emotion of art, and we need to understand that we need to stop alienating ourselves from death. We need to embrace it and understand that we all, unfortunately, will die. That and taxes are inevitable. And that's it, guys.